First aid. The main purpose of first aid is to prevent injuries or illness from getting worse until medical help arrives, until the professionals come on the scene, which could be the paramedics, doctors or nurses, who as part of their training are qualified first aiders. Don't become a casualty yourself. Assess the situation calmly, act quickly and confidently, don't panic. And don't move an injured person unless further injury or death is likely. In other words, if that injured person is comfortable where they are, there's no or nothing is going to impact on them to make things worse, then leave them where they are, stay with them. Unless something is about to fall on them or make matters worse, then you'll need to move them, because unnecessary movement could give them some sort of neck or spinal injury. Now, first aid boxes must be accessible to all, and report any missing items to your supervisor. And a question that quite often comes up in the exam is, what shouldn't be in a first aid box? Well, there shouldn't be any lotions, potions, creams, ointments, drugs, medicines, or chemicals of any description. Because even as a qualified first aider, you're not qualified to dispense such materials. So the sort of things you should get in a first aid kit includes things like a guidance leaflet, individually wrapped sterile plasters, sterile eye pads, triangular bandages, safety pins, sterile dressings of various sizes, and disposable gloves. Now, specific hazards will mean additional contents and extra facilities, for example emergency showers, but certainly no tablets or medicines. And all employees should be notified of kit locations and who the appointed or the first aiders are. Now, I say about the first aiders or the appointed persons, actually they, or the terminology changed for the appointed person in the 1st of October 2009. The 1-day course actually leads to an emergency aider qualification. And this is 1-day emergency first aid training. And they take charge of a situation when somebody's injured or becomes ill. The first aid qualification, that has changed from a 4-day course down to a 3-day course. And these people can administer treatment, for example CPR, and they ensure that a person's condition does not deteriorate before the medical professionals arrive. Now, under the First Aid Regulations 1981, it states that all businesses, regardless of size, must have appropriate first aid facilities. And this appropriateness, or the amount of first aid facilities, depends really on the type of business. For example, if the business works with hazardous substances or dangerous equipment, or they have a number of people with special needs or inexperienced workers, or working in remote areas, work that involves regular travel, load or shift work, or interaction with staff from another company or organisation, or the presence of members of the public. So it could mean that a business or organisation might just have one first aid kit for 10 people, or several first aid rooms with an occupational health nurse in full-time attendance. Information for employees under the Health and Safety First Aid Regulations 1981 include, first of all, there must be a notice of aiders and appointed persons, what we call now the emergency first aiders. Also, the location of first aid kits, and you must know where your first aid kits are retained. And lastly, you may need to provide these signs in another language. Okay, and let's go on to personal protective equipment. Now, personal protective equipment is or are items of equipment or clothing that prevents any injuries or illnesses from occurring to a person who's using that PPE. But it is the essential last resort. It's the last line of defence. Remember from the hierarchy of control measures, we must also... From the previous section with risk assessment, the first thing we must try with any risk assessment is elimination, followed by a substitution. Then the last thing to consider is personal protective equipment. What I'd like you to do now is to pause the presentation in a second and write down as many items of personal protective equipment you can think of, which includes clothing. So don't just think of your own workplace, think of all other workplaces. Think of the emergency services. Think about the police, fire, ambulance services. What about the armed forces? What equipment, what clothing do they use to prevent injuries or illnesses from occurring to them? So pause the presentation and write down your ideas. So how did you do with that? What we are looking at really is full body protection. Items you might have come up with include goggles, breather apparatus, hearing defenders, gloves, helmets, safety shoes or special clothing such as thermals or fire retardants or even deep sea diving equipment. Now, PPE is provided where risks to the health and safety cannot be controlled adequately by other control measures, such as elimination, substitution, and all the other measures that were mentioned earlier on. Now, all protective equipment must be suitable for the task and working environment, must give adequate personal protection, fit properly and comfortably, be compatible with other equipment used or worn, carry a CE mark to show that it complies with the necessary standards for design and manufacture. It's the employer's responsibilities to provide suitable equipment appropriate to the hazard and risks and to make sure it's comfortable and well fitting. They must carry out the initial assessment and compatibility tests. They must arrange for maintenance and replacement, and arrange for storage and cleaning arrangements, and provide instruction and training in the use of PPE. It's the employee's responsibilities to wear the PPE where instructed, to care for, clean and store the PPE properly, and lastly to report any defects. And that's very important, that last point. You do not suffer in silence if you've got any defects at all.